This video is sponsored by Surfshark VPN. It's been a long journey, but we are finally here with the final captain analysis video. This final video will be focusing on the leader of the Gotei 13, Head Captain Yamamoto. After having made videos on all of the other captains, it is interesting to see their perspectives of the head captain. While researching for this video, I was reminded of all of the bonds that he shared with the various different captains, like how he had recruited Yachiru Unohana, how he had taught Ukitake and Shunsui, his relationship with Kenpachi, how he had tried to teach him Kendo, and lastly, how he had recruited Seijin Komamura even though he wasn't a human. These are only a few notable examples of the impact that Head Captain Yamamoto had on his subordinates. As this video progresses, I want to really go through the legacy of Head Captain Yamamoto, how he had impacted the characters within the story, and had left a lasting impression on us the reader. Within anime and manga, there's a plethora of really powerful old and wise men. In Naruto, you have the Third Hokage. In One Piece, there's Whitebeard. Within Hunter x Hunter, of course, Isaac Netero. And even within Dragon Ball, the Turtle Hermit Roshi. What is consistent through all of these characters is the experience that they have, and the impression that they immediately give off that they are the strongest characters within that particular story. With the exception of Master Roshi, all of these old wise men that I have mentioned have left a long-lasting legacy, where we can really look back and marvel at their strength, endurance, and abilities. And for the most part, these elderly characters always sacrifice themselves for the next generation. Of course, we know that Head Captain Yamamoto does exactly this within the Thousand Year Blood War arc. The Captain Commander is one of the oldest and most powerful Shinigami, and in this video I'm going to be explaining why he is admired by all of the Shinigami, explaining the relationships that he has with his subordinates, as well as why he has a strong sense of duty towards the Soul Society. So let's dive into the analysis of Yamamoto Genryusai Shigekune. I'd like to thank Surfshark VPN for sponsoring this video. A VPN like Surfshark is an excellent added layer of security which keeps your personal information safe and your browsing history hidden. In the modern age, our reliance on the internet is like second nature. We use it for accessing personal banking, sensitive work-related documents, and even checking up on our investments. Surfshark keeps your data, current location, and even your IP address hidden, granting you safer access to the internet. Another great thing about using a VPN is that you can use it to gain access to content that may be region locked in your country. Surfshark allows you to bypass these restrictions, granting you access to a larger library of media. For example, on this channel we all love Bleach, but unfortunately in the UK I don't have access to watch the anime on Netflix. But thanks to Surfshark, I can change my location to America and I now have access to 5 seasons of the Bleach anime. At the moment, Surfshark has an excellent deal. If you use the promotional link in the description and use the code DBZimran, you can get 83% off and I added 3 months of service for no extra cost. Surfshark will also offer a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk for you not to try it. So support the channel by signing up to Surfshark VPN. Now let's get back to the video. The head captain first appears in chapter 81 of the manga and in episode 24 of the anime. His appearance as an old man is fitting for his position as the oldest captain within the Gotei 13. This is because in chapter 511 we learn that he actually founded the 13 court guard squads. The first thing that you'll notice about his appearance are his long eyebrows and his long white beard. In addition to this, Yamamoto's body is riddled with scars. He has 2 prominent scars on his head. These scars cross above his right eye. We learn in a flashback that one of them was given to him by his lieutenant. We don't really know the origin of the other scar, but some people assume that he sustained it during his first battle with Yhwach Bach. When the head captain takes part in battle, he removes the top half of his clothing, revealing a body that has been covered in scars. It makes you wonder how many battles the captain commander has taken part in. Yamamoto has a very strong sense of justice, and he has pride for his position as the captain commander of the Gotei 13. We learn during the Soul Society arc that the head captain believes that the justice of the world as a whole supersedes an individual's sense of personal justice. This is why he stubbornly sticks to the law and order of the Soul Society, not paying any care or consideration towards Rukia's feelings, even going as far as to lie to her just before she is going to be executed. We know that her final wish to the head captain was to spare her friends, who had come to rescue her. The head captain agrees not to kill Ichigo and the others, but we learn through Unohana's monologue to her lieutenant that these were only comforting words. The head captain still had every intention to capture and kill Ichigo and the others. At the point that we are introduced to the head captain within the story, he had been leading the Gotei 13 for over 1,000 years. Because of his dedication towards the Soul Society, he follows the laws and regulations of it very closely. He expects his subordinates to do the same. He demonstrates his intolerance towards insubordination when he expresses his anger towards Shunsui and Ukitake, who go against the law and order of the Soul Society in order to rescue Rukia. Due to his immense power and experience, he refers to those that he battles against as children or youngsters. Understandably, very confident in his own abilities, he doesn't expect much out of his opponents, and this leads to him referring to any battles that he takes part in as beatings or punishment. Literally, like an elder disciplining or teaching a lesson to a naive youngster. I emphasize his loyalty towards the Soul Society, because the head captain takes his duties extremely seriously, and he expects nothing less from his subordinates and the other captains of the Gotei 13. His sense of loyalty is so much so that he would even give his life for the preservation of the Gotei 13. He of course demonstrates this during the Fate Karakura Town arc, and ultimately does so during the Thousand Year Blood War arc. He also expects this from his subordinates, that if indeed a situation would arise where the existence of the Gotei 13 and the Soul Society were to be in danger, then they too should offer up their lives in order to stop such a threat. After all, this is their duty as members of the Gotei 13. In contrast to this, the head captain does not like to accept help from people who are not members of the Gotei 13. This is of course in reference to Ichigo and his friends. He does not like to involve the humans in matters of the Soul Society. Like I mentioned just now, the members of the Gotei 13 have a duty to give up their lives in order to protect the Soul Society, but he doesn't believe that Ichigo and the others have this same duty. He demonstrates this during the Fate Karakura Town arc, where in chapter 393 he uses his ability Enetsu Jigoku. Literally translating to Flames of Hell, this ability can incinerate an area which is much larger than Karakura Town, and it is for this reason that he tells Ichigo to get back. He does not have to share in the fate of the other members of the Gotei 13. Ichigo and his friends being humans have no business in matters involving the Soul Society, so yes, the head captain may allow them to assist in battle, but by no means is he relying on them or asking for their help. So with this brief explanation of his character, let's now dive into the head captain's backstory. I want to go through all of the mentions of the captain commander's past within the manga. This involves flashbacks which occur from the Soul Society arc all the way up until the Thousand Year Blood War arc. Let's try to understand more about the individual who had founded the Gotei 13, and what kind of a person he was in the past. During the Soul Society arc in chapter 155, you get the first mention of the head captain's past. During his battle with Shunsui and Ukitake, we learn that 2100 years ago, he had founded the Shinigami Academy. Sometime after this, he had also founded the Gotei 13. One of his earliest acts as the captain commander was to recruit Yachiru Unohana, dubbed the most diabolical criminal of the Soul Society. He had wanted her to join as one of the founding captains of the Gotei 13. During this time, he had also been teaching Ukitake and Shunsui at the Shinigami Academy when they were children. Due to this long-lasting connection that he has with them, he refers to them as his own sons. During chapter 504, we get a flashback of when the head captain was an instructor in his academy. We learn that his current lieutenant, Chojiro Sasakibe, used to visit him regularly, referring to him with the nickname Ijisai because of the scar on his head, which resembles the Japanese character E. During this chapter, the captain commander has a much younger appearance, with fewer wrinkles and black hair. Yamamoto was not fond of the nickname that Chojiro used to refer to him as, but he continued to stubbornly refer to him as Ijisai. We learn during this chapter that Chojiro wanted to be the right-hand man of the head captain, even going as far as to learn Bankai. To see whether if he is worthy of the position of his right-hand man, Yamamoto tells him to try and take him down with his Bankai. After demonstrating it, Yamamoto said that it was incredible, but it wasn't enough to take him down. Chojiro's Bankai had left a permanent scar on his forehead. Once the scar was fully formed, the two of his scars looked like the character's Jū, so people began calling him Jujisai, but his lieutenant Chojiro did not like this. He continued to call the head captain Ijisai, claiming that the scar that he had created on the head captain's forehead should not change his name. So head captain Yamamoto, for the sake of Chojiro, began calling himself Genryusai, so that others would stop referring to him as Jujisai. He did this for the sake of his lieutenant. In chapter 394, we learned that Yamamoto had become the head captain over 1,000 years ago, and it was around about this time that he had failed to kill Yhwach during the first Quincy Blood War. In chapter 511, we see a young Shunsui sneak into the head captain's office. A painting on Yamamoto's wall had caught his attention. Out of curiosity, he asks Yamamoto what the painting is of. As it appears, the painting is depicting a god of fire. He explains to Shunsui that this is a painting of a monster that showed up in the Soul Society a very long time ago. He states that the Soul Society was going through a very rough time, and when that god of fire appeared, it only made things worse. Yamamoto reassures Shunsui that this monster will never show up again, but if it ever does, then Yamamoto fears that that may be the last day of his life. This flashback and the exchange that he has with Shunsui reveals that he was ashamed of his past. He refers to a painting of himself as a monster, believing that this form of a fire of God that he had adopted led to the Soul Society experiencing even more turmoil during a already very difficult time. We can assume that Yamamoto had adopted this form of a monster 1,000 years ago during his battle against Yhwach. During the rematch that they have in the Thousand Year Blood War arc, Yhwach Bach refers to the past Yamamoto as a demon, stating that in the past he would go through any means necessary in order to defeat his opponents, going as far as to hold very little regard for humans in the real world, or even his own subordinates, treating them as easily replaceable pawns. It was only after the Quincy threat was defeated 1,000 years ago, and after attaining peace, that the head captain had decided to live with honor and justice. This is what led to his character changing, and I will talk more about the change that his character undergoes later on in the video, as the person that he grew to become is called into question by Yhwach Bach. Quite some time after this, we learn in chapter 138 that the head captain had allowed Seijin Komamura into the Gotei 13. He had accepted him when nobody else would, and shortly after this, Kenpachi was also enlisted as a captain of the Gotei 13, after killing the prior captain of the 11th division. Because he had attained the captain rank with no formal training, the head captain seemed it fitting to teach him swordsmanship. However, after only one lesson, he became concerned with the destructive power that Kenpachi had possessed. Along with the Central 46, he decided to cease Kenpachi's training, deeming him to be too dangerous to learn Kendo. Aside from his minor involvement during the Turn Back the Pendulum arc, this now brings us up to speed to the Captain Commander's first chronological appearance within the Bleach manga. In chapter 82, we get our first real impression of the Captain Commander, as well as the other captains of the Gotei 13. Yamamoto summons a meeting with the other captains to discuss the failure of Ginichimaru to kill Ichigo and his friends. His first act is to reprimand Mayuri and Kenpachi, who begin arguing with Gin. As the leader of this very powerful newly introduced group of characters, we can see that he is very strict and committed to his duty as their leader. As well as this, you see that he has very little patience, as he immediately demands an explanation from Gin as to why he allowed his targets to get away. On top of this, he is very quick to judge Ginichimaru's actions on whether if they are worthy of his rank as a captain of the Gotei 13. The meeting abruptly ends after Ichigo and his friends break into the Soul Society, concluding with the head captain deciding that Ginichimaru's punishment will be decided later. Along with the execution of Rukia, we can see that the Soul Society is very unforgiving. Along with Byakuya's first appearance within the story, the Captain Commander's introduction is our first look at a real authoritative figure within the Soul Society. You really fear for Ichigo and his friends after seeing the captains and their leader, and this is credited to Kubo's excellent character designs. Without these individuals even taking part in a single battle, you can tell that they are incredibly powerful. The design of Head Captain Yamamoto is no exception to this. After the defeat of Renji, in chapter 99, the head captain declares that the situation has become an emergency. In order to deal with Ichigo and his friends, the captain commander enlists the help of the best individuals for the task. He grants full wartime powers to the 13 court guard squads, allowing them to even use Bankai if necessary. Yamamoto takes no chances by declaring all-out war against the intruders. We don't really see the head captain again until chapter 150 at Rukia's execution. He describes how the Sokyoku will carry out the execution of Rukia. He looks on as Ichigo appears and rescues Rukia. He sends his lieutenant to deal with Ichigo while he confronts Shunsui and Ukitake after they destroy the Sokyoku. He orders them not to move in chapter 153. He notes the severity of their actions, stating that Ukitake and Shunsui have dishonored their rank as captains. The two of them try to escape, but the head captain demonstrates his incredible speed, because after they gain some distance on him, he appears in front of them. We now see just how much monstrous power the captain commander possesses. He is determined to punish the two of them for their actions. In chapter 155, we see the head captain releases Ryatsu for the first time. Shunsui's lieutenant Nanao is overwhelmed by the released Ryatsu. The head captain notices that Nanao is on the battlefield and refers to her as an infant and tells her to leave. Through Nanao's response, you can see how powerful the head captain is. Her eyes begin to water and her mouth foams. Of course, Nanao's expression is censored within the anime, but the manga really exaggerates and emphasizes Yamamoto's incredible power through Nanao's expression.
expression. After she is taken away from the battlefield, the head captain describes Shunsui and Ukitake when they were younger. He states that he was proud of them as if they were his own sons. It adds to the disappointment that he feels, as he had hoped that the two of them stayed on the same path that he has, where upholding the rules of the Soul Society supersedes any personal justice that they are seeking. Of course, in this context, they have gone against the rules of the Soul Society in order to protect Rukia, as they believe that executing Rukia is an excessive form of justice. The two of them try to talk it out with the head captain, but he states that there is nothing left to discuss, as he draws out his Zanpakuto, suggesting that the two of them do the same. As the head captain, he cannot be seen to be wavering in his resolve. He is the embodiment of the Soul Society. If he does not uphold and preserve the law and order of the Soul Society, then nobody else will. This is why the head captain does not want to talk with Shunsui and Ukitake. Despite his close bond with them, he needs to discipline them for breaking the rules. A battle begins immediately between the three of them, but unfortunately it is off screen. This doesn't really give us much of a chance to see the head captain's abilities on full display. But thankfully, at the end of chapter 155, we see the head captain release his Zanpakuto, as his Shikai Ryujin Jaka is unveiled. You may have assumed that the head captain is a frail old man, but his appearance now that he has removed his captain's coat is that of a muscular old man, whose body is covered in multiple scars, like I mentioned earlier. Ukitake perfectly describes the head captain's appearance here, as he feels fear and the weight of his spiritual pressure, comparing it to the weight of the deep sea, describing that the head captain's Shikai has transcendent spiritual pressure. It can even be stated that it is more powerful than some individual's Bankai. The heat that is emanating from his Zanpakuto is scorching the heavens and consuming even the clouds. Ukitake describes Ryujin Jaka as a Zanpakuto that can turn everything that it touches into ash. The captain commander possesses one of the most terrible, oldest, and greatest Zanpakuto. When challenged by such a powerful opponent, the two captains have no other choice but to release their own Shikai. After activating their Shikai, the head captain does marvel at their Zanpakuto, as he comments that Shunsui and Ukitake's Zanpakuto are the only dual-bladed Zanpakuto within the entire history of the Soul Society. The three of them finally clash and an explosion erupts as we cut away from the scene. After releasing this video, I have broken down this encounter from three different perspectives. Of course, we see here the perspective of the disappointed head captain. In my Shunsui character analysis, we see the cool, calm, and collected perspective, whereas in my Ukitake video, I go over how he was feeling anxiousness or apprehension, how Kubo drew the expressions on the faces of Shunsui and Ukitake very differently to match their own personalities. I really love this encounter between three of the most powerful shinigami within the Soul Society, students battling against their master, the differing reactions between Shunsui and Ukitake, the seriousness of the head captain, and ultimately the three of them not holding back, as the new generation clashes with the old. Shunsui and Ukitake cannot recall the last time that they had seen the head captain in this state. We can infer that they know full well the monstrous power of the head captain, as they have seen him in battle however many years ago. Of course, this is merely a glimpse into the true monster that the head captain is, the very monster that he resorts to transforming to in order to battle against Yhwach during the Thousand Year Blood War arc, and the very monster that he described to a younger Shunsui when he was intrigued by the painting within the head captain's office. In hindsight, coming back to this battle, I would have loved if we actually got to see it, but I think there is still some beauty in the way that Kubo had executed this. By teasing the abilities and powers of Ukitake, Shunsui, and the head captain, it gave us something to look forward to in the future, because when it comes to the head captain, we do get to see a lot of his abilities throughout the story. I was surprised at how many powers and abilities he had actually demonstrated when I was researching for this video. So when we finally do get to see the head captain use a power, it feels satisfactory because we have been looking forward to it ever since chapter 156, where we cut away from the battle between the three powerful shinigami. Their battle does eventually stop after the news that Aizen has betrayed the Soul Society is shared by Isane Kotetsu. So that wraps up the head captain's involvement within the Soul Society arc. He does have some minor appearances between now and the Fate Karakura Town arc, including where he orders the shinigami to prepare for war against Aizen, and he refuses to give Ichigo and the others permission to go and rescue Orihime, as he believes that going to Hueco-Mundo is suicidal. After all, he believes that Orihime had willingly gone to Hueco-Mundo of her own choice, and it is for this reason that he justifies not going to save her. Later, he orders the creation of Fate Karakura Town so that the captains could battle at full strength against the Espada, and of course Aizen. After arriving in Fate Karakura Town, his first act is to use an ability called Jogaku Enjo to trap Aizen, Tozen, and Gin, so that he and the other shinigami can focus on eliminating the Espada. In chapter 329, the head captain declares that the battle between the shinigami and the Espada has finally begun. He orders to defend the Soul Society with their lives, and to not allow the enemy to step foot onto the Soul Society. In chapter 337, the lieutenants are struggling against against Taribel's Frashion, who have combined into a beast called Ion. He is forced to intervene into the battle as he injures the Hollow by leaving a hole in its chest. The Captain Commander states that the lieutenants should be ashamed of themselves for forcing the Head Captain out onto the battlefield. After Ion survives the attack, the Head Captain states that he will have to punish it some more. It transforms and starts to grow larger in size. It charges towards Yamamoto as we finally get to see the Head Captain engage in battle. He releases his Zanpakuto and uses an ability to easily cut down Aeon. The Hollow is cut clean in half, but it is still moving. This is where the Head Captain begins to have pity for his opponent, as he says that he doesn't enjoy attacking stupid beasts. With ease, the Head Captain incinerates half of the Hollow by activating his Shikai. When Aeon is defeated, Haribel's Frashion attempt to attack the Head Captain. He admires their spirit and decides to lightly burn them so that they fall unconscious, deciding not to completely kill them. This is surprisingly different to the impression that we have of the Head Captain, especially when you compare actions like this to how Shunsui and Ukitake remember the Head Captain as. Clearly, he isn't the same monster as he was in the past. This is proven by how he didn't kill Haribel's Frashion. Clearly, he doesn't kill opponents unless it is absolutely necessary. In chapter 365, the Head Captain is surprised to learn that the Vizards are still alive. This is one of the first times where we really get an emotive expression out of the Head Captain. The Captain Commander ends up having a discussion with Shinji, wondering if they have arrived to seek revenge, but Shinji states that they want revenge against Aizen, not the Gotei 13. The Head Captain asks Shinji if they can consider them their allies, but he tells them that they are not the allies of the Gotei 13. They merely have a common enemy. If they are allies of anybody, then they are Ichigo's allies. In chapter 393, after sufficiently preparing, the Head Captain challenges Aizen. Aizen taunts him by saying that if he fails, then the Gotei 13 are essentially finished. When Aizen ends up impaling the Head Captain, he grabs him by the arm. Aizen questions the Head Captain whether if the arm that he is holding is indeed his, but Yamamoto isn't relying solely on his eyes or what he is feeling with his hands. He knows Aizen's spiritual energy after being cut by his Zanpakuto. There is no mistaking whose arm he is holding. We learn here that the Head Captain was preparing an ability called Enetsu Jigoku. Walls of fire suddenly erupt from the ground surrounding Aizen, and this is where the Head Captain tells Ichigo to get away, because the fallout from this attack is devastating. It will lead to everybody within Fate Karakura Town being eliminated, including the captains and lieutenants of the Gotei 13 that are present. Yamamoto is willing to go through such extreme lengths in order to take down Aizen, but because Ichigo is not a member of the Gotei 13, he cannot allow him to die here also. When Aizen questions him whether if he is okay with the other members of the Gotei 13 to fall victim to his attack, the Head Captain states that they are prepared for this. Like I mentioned at the start of the video, the Head Captain believes that it is the duty of the members of the Gotei 13 to die to eliminate great evil. He believes that this is the true purpose of the Gotei 13 that he had founded. However, his plans are thwarted with the arrival of Wonderweiss, who appears behind the Head Captain. The flames of his Zanpakuto appear to be dying out, as Aizen explains that Wonderweiss is the first modified Arrancar of its kind. He had sacrificed all of its other abilities in order to focus on one particular strength. This particular power is his Resurrection, which is named the Flame Extinguishing Prince. Aizen had created an Arrancar for the sole purpose of containing the flames of Yamamoto's Zanpakuto, and it is with this that Aizen bids farewell to the Head Captain, confident that he has defeated his opponent. Without being able to use a Zanpakuto, the Head Captain resorts to hand-to-hand combat. He delivers a devastating punch to Wonderweiss, which sends him flying. He explains to Aizen that he will not be defeated just because he cannot use his Ryujin Jaka. Describing Aizen as naive, he asks him why is it that there has been nobody else who has been the Captain Commander of the Gotei 13 for over 1,000 years. He explains that in all of this time, not a single Shinigami has been born that has been stronger than him. Using Shunpo, he appears in front of Aizen about to punch him, but his attack is blocked by Wonderweiss, who protects Aizen. The Head Captain blocks Wonderweiss's attacks and even rips off one of its arms, but several different arms grow from its back and begin to attack the Head Captain. Wonderweiss then restrains Yamamoto by grabbing onto his arms. With the Head Captain now unable to move, several more arms grow and they begin to punch Yamamoto simultaneously. But this is where the Head Captain demonstrates how much of a badass he is. Despite having just been punched over 100 times, he stands there unfazed, asking Wonderweiss if he is finished. He tears off the arms that are restraining him and states that he is glad that Wonderweiss no longer looks like a child, because he can now beat it to death without feeling any guilt. He then uses a Hakuda technique called Sokotsu, an incredibly powerful two-fisted punch. This attack completely destroys Wonderweiss. After defeating Wonderweiss, Yamamoto feels some remorse for his opponent. describing it as a poor creature. Thanks to Aizen's cruel actions, it was robbed of its emotions. Aizen reminds the head captain that he stated that Wonderweiss's ability was to contain the flames of Ryujinjaka. He reveals that the flames from his ability Ennetsu Jigoku were contained within Wonderweiss's body. The head captain is aware that if this energy is released, then it will cause devastating destruction, destroying the pillars around fake Karakura Town and causing destruction to the real world. The head captain rushes to contain the explosion, which erupts and causes devastating damage to the head captain. The incredibly smug Aizen thanks the head captain for saving the world. If he hadn't used his body as a barrier, then Karakura Town would have been destroyed. The head captain then collapses while Aizen approaches him. Aizen states that he will not spare the head captain, since he is the living embodiment of the Soul Society's history. He is everything that the Soul Society stands for. Just before Aizen can strike Yamamoto, he grabs his leg. He ends up using a sacrificial ability, numbered Hado number 96, Ito Kaso. He sacrifices his left arm in order to deal one final attack to Aizen before he collapses. And this is the head captain's final attack, as he continued to fight until he fell unconscious. And as we know, the rest of the battle continues, with Ichigo now facing off against Aizen. The head captain is seen again in chapter 423, 10 days after the defeat of Aizen. We see him telling off Shunsui, Byakuya, and Kenpachi for losing their captain's coats. Yamamoto's injuries appear to have been healed, apart from his left arm, which he has lost. Ukitake, who is listening in, is glad that the head captain has returned to his former self. He is grateful that nothing had happened to him during the battle with Aizen, as he states that no Shinigami within the Soul Society could take his place. The head captain has a minor appearance during the Forebring arc. In chapter 461, we see a meeting of the captains, where Urahara requests the head captain to restore Ichigo's powers. The captain commander agrees to restoring Ichigo's powers, since they were saved by Ichigo, and now it is their turn to save him. By doing this, he is going against the customs of the Soul Society, but he believes that it is justified. He says that it would be shameful if they did not assist Ichigo, who they owe so much to. He orders all of the captains and their lieutenants to place their ryatsu into the sword that pierces Ichigo, and eventually restores his powers. It is evident that the character of Head Captain Yamamoto has changed since his first appearance. You would not imagine him breaking the customs of the Soul Society during the first arc that he appears in. Ever since Ichigo and his friends have appeared and started to assist the Soul Society, his character has become a lot more accepting. Defeating Aizen certainly left an impression on the head captain. Because of this, I believe that the head captain now has a lot of respect for Ichigo. It is ironic that he now has respect for an individual who he had ordered to kill during the Soul Society arc. This now brings us up to the Thousand Year Blood War arc, where the head captain is only around for 32 chapters. We see the captain commander in chapter 482, where he is confronted by 7 masked men. They take out a messenger who is reporting to the head captain. I love how the Thousand Year Blood War arc begins. How the enemy decides to fearlessly confront the head of the Gotei 13. They tell Yamamoto that they are here to declare war against the Soul Society. With residents of Rukongai in Hollows disappearing, you wonder what on earth is going on. But everything becomes clear once the head captain is confronted by the enemy themselves. The intruders note how easy it was to infiltrate into the head captain's office. They advise that he should pay more attention towards his security, but in one of his most coolest moments, he states that he has nothing to fear. After all, he is here and there is no greater security than that. I love the way that Kubo has drawn the head captain here. He looks incredibly menacing, and somebody you wouldn't want to take lightly. When we cut back to this confrontation, we see the head captain's lieutenant Chojiro being thrown across his office, his body being propelled through the air by a large arrow that has impaled his body. Yamamoto calls out to his lieutenant, but the masked men advise him not to mourn for him, because his lieutenant had died a pointless death. By noticing the Quincy crosses, we can tell that the enemy that is threatening the Soul Society are Quincy's. The masked men tell the head captain that 5 days from now, the Soul Society will be annihilated by the Vanden Reich, the invisible empire of the Quincy. The masked men don't reveal their identities to the head captain, but they allow him to guess who they are. The intruders bid the head captain farewell as they escape into the shadows. Yamamoto promptly releases his Zanpakuto, unleashing flames upon the area where they were stood. After the smoke clears, we see that the intruders have already escaped. His attention now turns to his lieutenant, who with his dying breath is trying to relay something to him. He tries to tell Yamamoto that the enemy can do something with their bankai, but he is unable to complete his sentence before he dies. In chapter 486, we have the cremation of Chojiro. We learn that he was a man who swore his loyalty to the head captain. For as long as head captain Yamamoto was alive, he swore to be by his side. We learn that he was an incredibly powerful shinigami who had used his bankai for the first time in battle against the enemy, but it had still resulted in his death. Byakuya, who is also present at the cremation, states that the grief that the head captain must be feeling is beyond the imagination of any of the present captains, who have such little experience and knowledge when compared to Yamamoto. During this chapter, for the first time in the entire series, we see a somber expression on the face of the head captain. Mourning the death of his lieutenant, he looks to the floor and gives the order to light the fire so that the cremation can begin. We get a panel drawn by Kubo which shows us the expression from the head captain's eye. You can see the sadness and the grief in his eyes, and you can only imagine the pain that he must be feeling. The Thousand Year Blood War arc has one of the best introductions to any arc that I have ever seen. By killing the head captain's lieutenant, they have incurred his wrath. You can only imagine what on earth he will do when he sees the Quincy again. During chapter 488, we finally get a response from the head captain during a captain's meeting. The Soul Society's Research and Development Institute fill the captains in on everything that has been going on, as well as the identity of the army that has declared war upon the Soul Society. Of course, the head captain already knows this, but the army is made up of Quincy's. After Mayuri divulges more information, as well as Chojiro Sasakibe's dying words, which were that the enemy conceal and neutralize an individual's bankai, the head captain then interrupts Mayuri and tells him that this is enough information for now. All he wants to know is where is the enemy's base of operations, but unfortunately Mayuri does not know where it is located. So with no way of counterattacking the enemy, the head captain orders all of the other captains to prepare for battle, telling them that the enemy stated that they would be back in 5 days, but there is no point in trusting their words. He orders them to prepare for battle immediately. With conviction, he tells his captains not to allow the enemy to gain the upper hand again. Finally, after mourning, the fierce head captain that we know has returned. You can see that after the introduction of the enemy and the death of his lieutenant, he is gradually having to become that monster again. The monster that he transformed into in order to battle Yhwach Bach. A personality so fierce that he had to cast it aside, as it was a detriment to the Soul Society. In chapter 489, Mayuri and the head captain have a discussion, where Mayuri reveals to the head captain that he foresaw all of this happening the moment that he saw Uryu invade the Soul Society right at the beginning of the series. It was the head captain who ignored Mayuri's warnings, but Mayuri goes on to say that the main cause of this situation is the head captain himself, because he had failed to kill the leader of the Quincy army, Yhwach Bach, 1,000 years ago. When the Quincy return as promised, the head captain steps out, leaving his third seated officer in charge. In chapter 503, we see the stern Ritter Driscoll Bursey. He is battling against Shuhei Hisagi. We learn that this is the stern Ritter that had killed Chojiro Sasakibe. Just as he is about to deliver the final blow to Hisagi, the head captain intervenes, deflecting the same arrowhead that was used to kill his lieutenant. The head captain appears, protecting Hisagi. The stern Ritter is delighted to see Yamamoto. After all, his intention was to end the life of the head captain by using the stolen bankai of his lieutenant. The stern Ritter taunts the head captain as he states that Chojiro hadn't used his bankai in over 2,000 years. He tells the head captain that it must bring back memories for him to see his lieutenant's bankai again. It is here where we have that flashback that I spoke about right at the beginning of the video, with a younger Yamamoto and Chojiro referring to him as Ijisai. His lieutenant had demonstrated his newly formed bankai, which had scarred Yamamoto's forehead. We cut back to the present day where the stern Ritter attempts to use this very same bankai against the head captain. Yamamoto is attacked at point blank range by the stolen bankai. He remains silent as he takes the attack at full force. He eventually speaks and he says that Chojiro would be so humiliated that a stern Ritter is using his bankai that he had honed and generating such weak attacks with it. The head captain is angered by how the legacy of his lieutenant is being disrespected. His bankai was not this weak. With anger, he burns the stern Ritter with his shikai, immediately killing him. The head captain was finally able to avenge the death of his lieutenant. This is a Yamamoto that we have not seen before. He incinerates the stern Ritter, burning away his flesh. The flames even end up devouring his bones. Hisagi is shocked as he watches on. The head captain reassures him not to worry, because he will personally defeat each and every stern Ritter, including their leader, Yhwach Bach. We see the fearsomeness of head captain Yamamoto as he charges ahead. The other captains can tell that he is furious. The spiritual pressure of old man Yamamoto is resonating throughout the Soul Society. It increases the morale of all of the other Shinigami. At the end of chapter 505, he appears before Yhwach Bach, who is holding Kenpachi's lifeless body by the throat. At the end of this chapter, the head captain finally arrives to confront Yhwach Bach. They meet again after 1,000 years. He tells him that this time he has come to take his life. The stern Ritters Asnot, Nanana, and Basbi attack the head captain from above, but he incinerates them with his shikai. Yhwach Bach has no sympathy for the three stern Ritters, as he states that they are fools for trying to interfere with his battle. Yuha tells Yamamoto that he has grown old, but he notes that seeing the head captain's anger overwhelm him reminds him of his younger days, and it is here that we see this glimpse of head captain Yamamoto during the first battle with Yhwach Bach, and it is really unfortunate that we don't get to see a fully fledged fleshed out battle from 1,000 years ago, but Kubo teases us through these subtle glimpses into the past. The head captain strikes first, but Yhwach Bach evades the attack. He then draws his own sword made up of reishi. It appears that the head captain was waiting for Yuha to draw his sword. He was anticipating it so that he could crush his flesh, blood, and his sword. Suddenly, the flames from Yamamoto Zanpakuto Ryujinjaka disappear. Chapter 506 concludes with the painful cliffhanger of the head captain saying Bankai, Zanka no Tachi. Yhwach Bach advises Hashward not to take the Bankai of Yamamoto lightly, as everything it cuts is burnt by an explosive flame. His Zanpakuto literally embodies the fires from hell. We learn that Yhwach Bach had seen the head captain's Bankai 1,000 years ago. He wonders if it is still the same as before. After the head captain activates his Bankai, the entire atmosphere of the Soul Society changes. Across the Serete, various different individuals react to the warmth that is generated from his Bankai. Ukitake's throat begins to dry up. Shunsui's lips begin to crack. Unohana notices that the water from a vase has evaporated. Even Hyorimaru, which is being used by the Sternritter Kangdu, begins to evaporate. All of the moisture within the Soul Society is disappearing gradually. Ukitake and Shunsui are well aware that the head captain has activated his Bankai. Yamamoto immediately strikes Yuha, but he is confused as to where the flames from his Zanpakuto have gone. But he soon learns that the flames are emitted from the tip of the Zanpakuto. During this battle against Yhwach Bach, we learn that the head captain's Bankai has four different sections: east, west, south, and then lastly north. Zanka no Tachi east concentrates all of the heat of his Zanpakuto into the tip of the blade. Neither does it burn nor does it emanate any flames. It just blows away everything that it touches without a trace. It is so powerful not even the Quincy's defensive ability Blut Veen can stand up to it. Yuha naively states that all he has to do is defeat the head captain without being cut by his blade, but Yamamoto reveals to him that if his Zanpakuto has an east, there is also a west. He activates Zanka no Tachi west. Immediately, heat begins to emanate, which reaches 15 million degrees. Now Yuha will be unable to even lay a finger on the head captain. He has literally become the sun itself, with his Zanpakuto and his body being surrounded by burning flames. The head captain says that it is time to end this. If he does not conclude this battle soon, then himself along with the entire Soul Society will burn to the ground. Thanks to the heat generated from Yamamoto's Bankai, Yuha feels like he is burning. If it wasn't for his Blut Veen defense, then he would be reduced to ashes even at this distance. The head captain questions if he is just going to stand there and watch. After all, Yuha's sword was broken moments ago. He tells him that he won't blame him if he decides to run away, but Yamamoto is determined to catch up to him and kill him. He then begins to fire arrows towards Yamamoto. While Yamamoto charges towards him, Yuha activates an ability called Church Song, Sanctuary Praise. It appears to be the Quincy's ultimate offensive and defensive chant. He warns the captain commander that if he steps into this, then his body will be torn apart by God's light. But old man Yamamoto retaliates by stating that he cannot harm him. Yamamoto then activates Zanka no Tachi South, as it appears that he is reviving the dead, who had died by the flames of his Zanpakuto. Several skeletal corpses rise from the ground, ready to attack Yhwach Bach. Yuha insults Yamamoto by telling him that he is a disgrace to the Shinigami by bringing back the dead to life. He tries to break through the pile of corpses that are restraining him, but he realizes that these are the faces of his dead comrades, his subordinates that the head captain had killed 1,000 years ago. He recognizes the faces of several of his men that are now restraining him. Now that Yhwach Bach has been successfully restrained, the head captain begins to make some distance between them. He questions if Yuha is regretting not having stolen his Bankai earlier, but the head captain states that it's not that they chose not to steal his Bankai, it's that they couldn't steal it. The captain commander assumes that the Quincy can only steal Bankai once they understand the full power of a Bankai, and since the head captain hasn't shown the true form of his Bankai, they are unable to steal it. It appears that Yhwach Bach is going to be defeated, as his emotions are overwhelming him, but the head captain doesn't hesitate in the slightest. As he avenges the deaths of all of the Shinigami that the Quincy have killed, he activates Zanka no Tachi North, which is a single swift strike of concentrated fire and heat, which incinerates and burns everything out of existence that it touches. And this is what exactly happens when it makes contact with Yhwach Bach's body. His arm and his torso is completely erased as he collapses to the ground. Yamamoto then undoes his Bankai as he looks on at the body of his defeated opponent. But what is strange is that he notices that Yhwach Bach is apologizing and asking for forgiveness from Lord Yhwach Bach. But this is when Yamamoto realizes that he wasn't facing off against Yhwach Bach, but instead an imitating Sternritter called Lloyd Royd. He turns around to see an explosion from his first company barracks. Realizing that his third seated officer Okikiba has been caught up in the explosion, he shouts out his name. But this is when the real Yhwach Bach appears behind Yamamoto. We learn that while Yamamoto was facing off against a doppelganger, Yhwach Bach had gone gone to see Aizen in the Central Underground Great Prison. He had attempted to recruit him, but his offer was declined. Yamamoto attempts to activate his bankai in retaliation to Yhwach Bach, but his bankai is stolen by the leader of the Quincy. He reveals that it's not that they couldn't steal this bankai, it's just that nobody else but Yhwach could control the immense power of his bankai. Yhwach Bach then waves his sword across the air and a large reishi sword falls from the ground. Gripping this blade, he bids farewell to the head captain as he strikes him across his body. The next chapter, 511, begins with that flashback that I mentioned earlier on in the video, of the painting of the monster that the head captain had turned into, with the words of the head captain resonating in our minds, that if that monster was to show up in the Soul Society again, then that will mean the end of Yamamoto's life. We see the face of a beaten and tired Yamamoto, still stood on his feet after being striked by Yhwach Bach. His body is then cut in two, from the shoulder to the waist. In this devastating chapter, we see his sons Shunsui and Ukitake react immediately. Chapter 511 is titled Die Standing. Yhwach insults the head captain, stating that he may have been the head of the Soul Society, but his defeat was pitiful. With his final ounce of strength, the head captain, as if to say that he is still fighting, grabs onto Yuha's cloak. This is incredibly brutal. As the leader of the Quincy cuts off his arm, Yhwach steps on the head of the captain commander, referring to him as a halfwit. He explains why Yamamoto wasn't listed as one of the war potentials that he had wanted to recruit. He questions the corpse of the captain commander. Why is it that he didn't heal his left arm after the battle with Aizen? He could have done so, but he was too stubborn to accept assistance from a human like Orihime. He didn't want to have any assistance or to exploit humans. He was even reluctant to have Ichigo involved in the battle against Aizen. During his battle against Yhwach Bach, the head captain wasn't only fighting for the Soul Society, but he was also shouldering the burden of the world of the living. Despite bearing such a heavy burden, the head captain was ultimately killed. Yhwach states that Yamamoto had gotten weak. He was different from 1,000 years ago. The original Gotei 13 that the head captain had founded were a group of cold-hearted killers. They were only guardians of the Soul Society by name, but in actuality they were ruthless. Yhwach Bach states that it is for this reason that they were to be greatly feared, and it was head captain Yamamoto who had kept them in line. With his Zanpakuto Ryujinjaka, he was a monster that nobody would challenge. He would use anything and everything in order to defeat his opponents. He would have even cast aside the life of his subordinates if it meant victory for him. But Yhwach Bach states that Yamamoto had changed once the Quincy were killed. Once the Shinigami had experienced peace, they began to protect and to love more. Because of their sense of justice and pride, they became hesitant. He describes this new iteration of the Gotei 13 as a bunch of gutless, foolish individuals. Yhwach Bach's final words to the corpse of Yamamoto are that he died not realizing that the Soul Society is about to die. The true Gotei 13 died 1,000 years ago with the death of the Quincy. The new Gotei 13 are nothing more than poor imitators, according to Yhwach Bach. With this, he destroys the body of the head captain, where the only thing remaining is his Zanpakuto. And this is how the story and legacy of head captain Yamamoto ends. He dies not knowing the fate of his Soul Society or his subordinates, having been defeated by an enemy that he failed to defeat 1,000 years ago. The death of the head captain was merciless. He had no solace in his final moments, no hope that the situation would get better. He died not knowing the fate of the Gotei 13 that he had founded, unaware if the legacy of the Shinigami would end, and if he would be even remembered at all by anybody. I find the beginning of chapter 511 to be very poetic, as we have this brief glimpse into the past, the head captain foreshadowing his own death by stating that if that monster would appear again, then that would mean that he would not return again. There was truth to these almost prophetic words. The head captain died standing on his feet, which is an excellent callback from his poem from volume 45. Kubo writes, "Don't live bowing down, die standing up." And this is on the volume where Head Captain Yamamoto features on the cover. This volume was written years before the actual death of Head Captain Yamamoto. The Head Captain also features on the cover of the volume where these chapters occur, on the cover of volume 58. The poem on this volume states, "The heart burns even though rain falls." We can infer that the burning is the legacy of Head Captain Yamamoto, as his body lays on the ground in the rain. He grabs onto the cloak of Yhwach Bach, clearly his heart still burning. Now that he has died, the remaining members of the Gotei 13 remain, upholding his legacy. This was quite the lengthy video, but I feel that it was necessary to explain the legacy of the head captain. I think this video does a good job of explaining why the head captain is such a well-written character, and how Kubo fully fleshed out the abilities of head captain Yamamoto. He tied together all of his story and wrapped up all of the loose ends. The only issue that I genuinely have is that we didn't get to see the first battle against Yamamoto versus Yhwach Bach 1,000 years ago. I mentioned it so many times in this video, but I would have loved to have actually actually seen it occur in the manga. After seeing the events of chapter 511, the poem from volume 45 makes a lot more sense. Similar to Whitebeard from One Piece, who had died standing on his feet during the Marine Ford arc, the Head Captain also stands on his feet until his body is cut down, and the poem from volume 45 foreshadows this precisely. Prior to making this video, I didn't really have much consideration or care for even the lieutenant of Head Captain Yamamoto, but after researching for this video and analyzing the relationship between Chojiro Sasakibe and the Head Captain, I have a lot more appreciation for him, and it really helped me to understand the emotions that the Head Captain must have been feeling after the death of his lieutenant. Now, I want to ask, what are your thoughts and opinions of Yamamoto Genryusai Shigekune? Do you feel that his character was well written, or do you feel like there were a lot of missed opportunities, especially in regards to Kubo expanding upon more of his past? I look forward to reading through your thoughts of this character. And lastly, if you did enjoy this video and you like the content that I produce on this channel, then remember to support the channel by checking out the sponsor of this video, Surfshark VPN. And once again, thank you for making it to the end of the video. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see more like it, then please consider supporting my channel on Patreon. I have multiple tiers with rewards including access to an exclusive Discord server, video scripts, as well as being the first to know about unreleased upcoming videos. Thank you for your time, and whatever you choose to contribute, I will appreciate and it will mean a lot to me.